Okay, so I'm Laure Nunager. I'm CNRS researcher working in Besançon, in the laboratory of Chrono Environnement and at the MSHE Claude Nicolas Ledoux. And
I am Damien Vaupio, and I am working at the University of Tours. I am a 3D specialist and an archaeologist also. I will let you introduce the talk.
Though we will present an experiment developed to acquire a series of high resolution measurements using T LiDAR scanner. We will focus especially on the measurement quality and on the precision of the absolute positioning by using a double survey, a laser grammetric survey, and a topographical survey. So this double survey was possible thanks to a partnership between the Maison des Sciences de l'Homme et de l'Environnement and the city of Besançon, and especially the team who were carried out the topographical survey. And this research is partly supported by the Regional Council of Bourgogne-Franche-Comté within the ORTEP project. So the 3D data acquisition focused on the military building, the Tour de la Pelote, located in Besançon, which is a city situated in the northeast of France, not far away from here. La Tour de la Pelote is a late Middle Age tower, which was included in the Vauban's fortified architectural program by the end of 17th century. This fortification is now part of the UNESCO World Heritage, and the citadel, which is dominating the whole center of the city, is one of the most beautiful pieces of the Vauban's work. The Tour de la Pelote was mentioned for the first time at the beginning of the 15th century. The tower was rebuilt by the end of the 16th century before to be integrated in the defensive system planned by Vauban. It has to be underlined that this different step of rebuilding had an important impact on the building itself, but as well on its topographical environment, which was modified several times, and especially by the urbanization until the end of the 20th century. So it is therefore quite challenging to record this small building in 3D. Also, in 2013, the Tour de la Pelote was ravaged by a fire, and considering its heritage value, a program of restoration started in 2015. A building archaeological survey was then realized in 2016 in order to guide the restoration. The roof was completely rebuilt identically by a master carpenter, and all the masonry were restored. Both operations, so the restoration and the archaeological survey, were realized by the city of Besançon under direction of the Regional Heritage Management Office. And this operation have motivated a new project for a public mediation with the tourism guided tours and so on. Unfortunately, for security reasons, it is impossible to visit this tower. So the 3D project of the tower was then decided to have a virtual access to the interior of the building. And in addition, this 3D project was seen as a new way to think the preservation of historical monument in case of damage, with a continuous opportunity to study the heritage building based on the previous measurement. So as such, the fundamental aim of the project was to design a survey protocol in order to produce a reliable digital model for scientific purpose. And because of the challenging building layout and the topographical context, we need to get the most accurate relationship between floors. There is four floors in the tower, as well as a reliable geolocalization of the resulting point cloud. Based on the outdoor and indoor recordings, from a methodological point of view, We were specifically interested in the measurement errors and in the accuracy of the point position with a subcentimetric resolution. So in order to solve our problems, we designed an acquisition protocol based on the lagrimetry and high-precision topographical survey. And both surveys were based on a common reference using topographic points and targets located inside and outside of the building. So we have, so as to have some reference with the same position visible inside and outside, some of the targets were located on purpose on the window for each on each floor. And the implementation of the common reference were jointly decided before the survey was carried out by the two teams. So the high precision measurement of the targets used for the lasergrammetry were done in three steps using the Ertica GPS and two types of total station. First, the team measured the position X and epsilon of the targets from outside and inside. To start, they designed a general canvas with some position of reference located around the tower in red. What happens? Sorry. So located at less than 30 meters in order to respect the optimal quality of the measurement. And the coordinate of the canvas position were measured in first instance by the RTK GPS with a centimetric precision. Pardon. The precision of the canvas position was then improved by a triple measurement of each point in order to get a millimetric position using a total station. Then, in order to link outside and inside, keeping this millimetric precision, an intermediate measurement of an inside position in green was done using the outside canvas. Based on this intermediate position, additional points of reference in orange were measured inside, and they are used as a systematic point of control for the following measurement. Then the total station was used as a free station in order to record the coordinates X and Epsilon of the lasergrammetry targets. This record was done systematically using the additional point of reference, though in orange, to control the millimetric precision based on the standard deviation processing of this point. When the precision was up of 5 millimeters, the position was excluded and we made a new free station. So after the X and Epsilon measurement for each position, a second step, B, was dedicated to the measurement of the Z axis for each position located inside of the tower. The elevation was measured using a laser level and it was based on the outside canvas position. Then, in the last step, C, by using a topographical software, we assessed the global quality of all scan, and it consists in reprocessing topographical trajectories in order to validate the canvas and to estimate the consistency of the measurement series. Despite this very rigorous procedure, it is important to underline that within the narrow space, when we have the possibility to have just a single measurement in free station, the X and Epsilon position can be validated with this control. But it is impossible to estimate the Z axis error automatically. And so in order to overcome this problem, we recommend to make a double record of such a position with a new free station. This operation allows an auto-control before the processing of the lasergrammetric point clouds.
I will take over from you. So for the laser gravimetric survey, so it was necessary to take about 50 scan positions, around 5 to 10 positions for each flow. And in addition, as we said earlier, we started to make scans outside in order to replace the tower in its local topographic environment. And for each scan, the scanner is recording a dome which ignores a portion corresponding more or less to the tripod of the scanner. For each scan, laser gravimetric records are supplemented by a photogrammetric acquisition, which covers the entire scene and is allowing us to colorize point clouds afterwards. So it's a fisheye lens, and we are taking 5 pictures for each scan position. So, however, in order to obtain a relative homogeneity, it was necessary to illuminate the darkest areas and compensate for overexposure effects when windows were directly visible from the camera. So we chose to place scans in such a way as to cover as much space as possible. Okay, I think you have moved my anyway. Yeah, you move on the wrong slide. Okay, we just switch this one. So with so many scans covering the entire building, as you can see on the screen, each color is a different scan. Taking also into account the inherent difficulty of every floor and stair, the registration process was quite challenging, as you may imagine. We chose to go with a multi-step registration process. So first, we started with local registration using the own scanner local coordinate system. For each floor, the scan with the most available targets was taken as a reference. And then, as much as possible, every other scan from the same floor was registered to the reference scan in order to form what we call a bundle. With every floor registered, it was not possible to perform what we could call an inter-bundle adjustment. And to do so, we registered stairs together in pairs, going from top to bottom. This way, it was possible to somehow overcome or mitigate potential stairs registration difficulties and loss of accuracy already from the first registration step. So moving to the next step, we are moving from a local coordinate system to a geographical coordinate system. So in order to do that, we injected the results from the topological survey to the 4 most accurate targets with the highest number of operands on each floor. The process itself is not perfectly rigid, since minor adjustments are performed both to the corresponding local coordinates and the newly inserted geographical coordinates to accommodate ensuing geometric distortion. All in all, in terms of accuracy, the process of moving from local to geographical coordinates depends on the quality of the initial registration, obviously, and also the accuracy of the topological surveys that we presented earlier. The errors are accumulated in such a way that the impact is not homogeneous over the data set. It is more like a local impact focused on targets and that propagates itself until it reaches the impact radius of another target. So lastly, the third registration step is about fine-tuning. So even if we have good results from the 2 previous steps, there are always minor inconsistencies or loss of accuracies remaining. And depending on the final product required, we can proceed with a drastic visual and statistic inspection that would result in a very clean and nice-looking point cloud at price of maybe accuracy. Or if you are prioritizing the accuracy, we can be a little more subtle at price of visual quality. So in our case, we took the second option and fixed a statistical threshold under 0.01 meter for standard deviation. Obviously, as you can see on the table, a few scans were still outside the threshold and had to be adjusted. So it was most of the time tighted position for which the narrow scanning areas resulted in loss of information. Some wells were too close from the scanner, and some tighted position implied that the scanner is also record its own tripod. So consequently, we had a less good point of reference to finally register the scan. So The adjustment was performed through low density point tools, plane fitting, and ICP, so iterative closest points. And it should be noted that even if the statistical result displayed an outstanding level of accuracy, some visual residual error remains, and it's inevitable with so many scans and well within our tolerance margin. But it also reminds us that one should not take statistical results for granted. So we also did some cleaning, some rough preliminary cleaning, in order to get rid of points outside the building, so windows and such, and the scanner mount recorded from tighter measurement series. Then we moved toward automatic cleaning with a light noise filter. The idea was to delete duplicated points within a submillimetric contiguity threshold, and also to remove remaining statistical outliers. We were most likely too cautious, and it would be reasonable to iterate again with higher values to definitely remove not entirely overlapping point from the same surface or plane. We also subsampled the point cloud with a 1 millimeter spatial grid to work with a reasonably big data sets for a structure of this scale, which amount around 300 million points. And clearly there is almost no point keeping more points on the initial quarter of a millimeter grid suggested by the scanner is too low. We are not really improving the visual fidelity at cost of performance and file size. Moreover, we are below the accuracy threshold of our survey. So I will finish with a smile video if I can launch it. Yeah, maybe, oh yeah, it's moving, okay. So we are also using Pottery. And the operating chain that we developed for this project proved to be metrologically efficient. As a result of that first experience and taking into account the complexity of the building, results raised some methodological problems ranging from the topographic measurement to the lack of color equalization on some places, as you can see behind me. There is no doubt that we could improve this protocol by developing it and by confronting it with new contexts. And lastly, we still have to enrich our dataset with the archaeological study as an overlay that will be then made available to researchers and general public through a self-hosted web viewer. And tomorrow, we will also present a way to work with data integration. How can we make work together 3D meshes, point clouds, rasters, and vectors inside the same WebGL viewer? So if you can come tomorrow, come. Thank you very much.